quarterback from the
Crappy.
Jesse, I know you're disappointed in losing the Crappy.
I'm a little disappointed.
And the, you know, the flood causing that and all.
Yeah, the damn flood.
But you made reference earlier, you have been at this a long time, and though your talent seems undeniable to those of us in this room, there was a point at which it had been denied. Did you ever think of turning tail and heading back home and not doing music?
Absolutely. The problem is I don't have a college degree or anything remotely to fall back on. I was a horrible sandwich artist at a Subway. That was my title. I was really, I had a little shirt that said
we should write that song for the worst song next year.
Okay, yes, we will
sandwich
win.
Sandwich artist.
We will win. I was really bad at everything else, so to answer your question, there wasn't really an option for me to not succeed at this in some form or fashion. It just took sheer desperation, determination.
You had some desperation, and you also had people in your corner who also seemed like undeniable talents, and one of them you married, and he's a guy who was in Emmylou Harris's Nash Ramblers band that saved the Ryman Auditorium with a concert called Live at the Ryman in the early 90s, and he is a remarkable songwriter who helped to pen Whisky Lullaby, one of the better songs of our time. And whatever happened to that guy?
I don't know. Should we make him sing Whisky Lullaby? Yeah. Jon Randall, take the snack bar, please. Come out here. Yeah, you can sit right here. Don't leave. So me and this guy have been together for almost 15 years. I can remember him when his little tiny apartment, he'd just written the chorus to Whisky Lullaby, and I remember he didn't have furniture yet, but you had Whiskey and Merle Haggard records. I said, I'm in. That's all we needed. And we would sit around and play new songs for each other, and he was like, I got this little piece of a song, and he would play me Whiskey Lullaby, and I'd just think, oh, that's so sweet, honey. That's so cute. Like,
that's a sweet, cute double suicide song.
Exactly.
Unless it was
it's a nice little sing-along, but...
Come on, kids, everybody join in.
Nobody's ever going to record that. Ever, right? And then, damn it if it didn't go number one, Brad Paisley and Alison Krauss. And then win Song of the Year in 2005, so...
Oh, well, I did not know I was doing this. I thought I was singing harmony on a couple of things. It was cool to get to sing with her and Trisha Yearwood. That was pretty greatness. I know we're going to keep it short here, but I just got to tell you that I grew up in Dallas, and I was a Dallas Mavericks fan, and the first year they made the playoffs, I went and bought one of the first HD televisions you could buy, and I got it all set up that night, and Jessie came home. She was all jazzed up. She said, I got this really cool idea for a song. He don't know nothing about Memphis. It's this idea. And I was like, yeah, let's work on that tomorrow, honey. It's first period. In a little bit, we'll work on that. So the next morning, she went and wrote it with Tommy Lee James. And Trisha recorded it like 2 weeks later. And the Mavericks lost the damn playoffs. So it was a fail across the board. So. That bottle to his head and pull the trigger. strength he had to get up off his knees. We found him with his face down in the pillow, with a note that said, I'll love her till I die. When we buried him beneath the willow, the angels sang a whiskey lullaby. La 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 la. And the rumors flew, tried to hide the whiskey on her breath. She finally drank her pain away a little at a time, but she never could get drunk enough to get him off her mind until the night. She put that bottle to her head and pulled the trigger. Life is short, this time it was bigger than the strength.